Greetings, welcome to part one of this little tutorial series where I'm going to break down how to program drums from scratch, particularly acoustic or realistic style parts. So maybe you want to start making your own drum parts yourself and you've just picked up Logic or Ableton or something like that for the first time, and you've probably got some pretty good ideas for drum parts, but you've got no idea where anything is or what the hell anything does. So I just wanted to make this for anyone wondering how to do this, and hopefully by the end of it all you'll be well on your way and have a pretty decent understanding of how to program most kinds of beats, particularly in terms of MIDI patterns and creating original ones yourself. You can do this in basically any DAW, and the beauty of it is that you can do it pretty much anywhere with just a laptop. Even though I'm doing this in Logic, these methods are pretty much the same and can translate across to other DAWs like Ableton as well. I'm going to be using Logic's built-in drum kit designer for the majority of this, as it comes included in this app, but these programming methods are exactly the same if you're using something like Addictive Drums 2, which I'm also going to get into in the later sections. The main difference between these two things is that Addictive Drums 2 has more options and better drum sounds in it compared to something like drum kit designer, but I'll get into more on that later. I'm going to start from the basics and gradually work up to more complex ideas to try and provide a pretty comprehensive understanding of how you can do this all yourself in a range of different styles or genres, and especially or particularly if you're not a drummer but you want to be able to write music. So, the three tools that you are going to be using for this are the
Pencil
tool, the Velocity tool, and the Quantize tool. You're going to be swapping between them quite quickly, so it's helpful to get used to the keyboard shortcuts to kind of, you know, just flip between the Velocity and Pencil tool, so T and P or T and V.
And some pencil erasers for rubbing out mistakes.
So, starting fresh in Logic, if I create a new track and I go to this drum kit designer here, I'm going to just select a stereo output version, create the track, and you can see it's just done that here. Use the pencil tool to click in a region on the grid and then open it up. This is where we can start kind of clicking in our notes, and you can see that drum kit designer labels every MIDI key with that sample or drum articulation that's mapped to it, right? So you can see we've got the kick here, the snare types here, got some hand claps. So obviously you can just start kind of clicking in patterns like this. And I can, you know, you can do things like copy and paste segments like that out to make things a bit quicker. And if I just sort of click in your basic kind of...
This is rock and roll.
The second thing is obviously the Velocity tool is going to control how hard or how loud each bit of the kit is being played. So if I grab the Velocity tool, if I drag that all the way up to its maximum value at 127, you can see that the color of these notes goes bright red, and that's like the kick being played as hard as the drummer could possibly hit it, right? The opposite end of the spectrum going down to these cooler colors is where it's, you know, being played really softly. By varying velocities, you can get quite, you know, different dynamic things kind of happening. Yes, that's a little bit odd. Takes a bit of time adjusting things. And then the quantizing tool is going to be useful for basically snapping things to particular grid values, and particularly for anything that kind of goes off of these grid lines, like triplets. It can be quite easy to just achieve with using this quantize menu over here on the left. I tend to prefer this rather than using the quantize tool in the menu here. So for example, if I want to just create like a little hi-hat triplet fill, if I just copy out, you can see I've clicked those all in and they've all snapped to grid lines. But if I highlight that chunk of notes and then I come over to this quantize menu, and if I put them in eighth note triplets, you can see how it just sort of shuffled them around a little bit there. I'm going to remove that one and let's just see what that did. So if you quickly want to create a little crescendo there, if you highlight a bunch of notes like that and then you come up to this Functions MIDI Transform menu, there's a bunch of options in here to kind of change how that MIDI is behaving essentially and what the programming is. So for example, if I want to do a crescendo, if I click that, it brings up this kind of crazy looking menu. Hit Operate See, now you can see that it's basically created a ramping up with all of those notes to go from the quietest, the lowest velocity to the highest, or nearly the highest. Maybe I can do it with the hi-hat as well, right? Operate only, that horrible looking menu. That's kind of how you can start programming drums. Pretty much just a lot about the interplay between, you know, the Velocity tool and the Quantize tool, I think. It's not immediately obvious how you'd achieve certain drumming techniques or articulations when you're using MIDI like this, and there's certain things like hi-hat barks, cymbal catches, and kind of ghost note things that are not obvious in terms of how you'd achieve them. So how do you do that? So to start out with the good old hi-hat bark, and I believe that is the commonly used term for when a drummer plays the kick drum and the open hi-hat like at the same time, but you quickly close the hi-hat to get that kind of psh sort of thing going on. That sort of weirdly satisfying slap across the face thing. I think this is a pretty important component of modern drumming, so to do that in MIDI, if you basically have an open hi-hat here, you can hear if I play that, it'll just ring out, and what you need to do is put down a closed hi-hat note after it, and that'll determine where it ends up closing. So if I put a kick on the open hi-hat note with it, that's kind of how you get that happening. And obviously where, depending on how far away this closed note is from this open one up here, you know, you can kind of get some interesting rhythmic interplay going on like that, you know, it kind of determines how long that stays open for. So that's how you control that. And it's pretty similar with the cymbal catch. You've got this specific sample mapped to it here. So, you know, like hitting the cymbal and then grabbing it to choke it out and stop it ringing out. So that kind of thing. In Addictive Drums 2, it works the same way as the hi-hat, where you've got like the open crash and then a specific MIDI note to close it afterwards. And then, yeah, the other thing is just ghost notes, basically. So again, that's pretty simple to address if you're sort of thinking about the Velocity tool and the idea that, you know, a ghost note is just a really quiet kind of bounce note that can happen.
Don't worry about those ghost notes. Ain't nothing but rebound.
If I set the BPM a little bit faster. So I've got this kind of, yeah, molar hi-hat pattern sort of thing here. That is how you achieve that. You've basically just got, you know, your accent note is a bit louder and you're in between bounce notes are going to be a little bit quieter, so something like that. And then, yeah, obviously that's kind of a little bit undetailed, so to get some kind of, you know, more realistic drummer bounces in there, I'm just going to put some very quiet velocity notes on the snare center track in kind of places like this. And that's how you can get that kind of nice snare buzzing, that kind of choppy thing going on. If I put them in between the hi-hats here like that. The combination of all these elements and, you know, doing things like putting hi-hat barks here and there. And yeah, obviously in this environment, it's just quite fun to kind of shift things around and see what kind of different creative results you get, I think so. And yeah, you can see there that what I've done is kind of disrupted that rhythm of the molar, the kind of static thing, you know, the accent happening on every downbeat here. You kind of just shift that around by changing the velocity notes so they're a bit quieter. And then the offbeat hit here is actually the loudest one. So it kind of interrupts the sequence a bit without destabilizing it. So that's pretty much how you achieve some pretty key kind of articulations or important articulations when it comes to realistic sounding drumming. One other thing that might be good to be aware of when it comes to programming drum grooves and just making your life a bit easier, particularly if you want to program things that are kind of fast or a bit more technical, it's just worth bearing in mind how Logic's grid kind of looks or behaves a little bit differently depending on what BPM you've got your song set at. Basically program two versions, it's the exact same groove, but they're programmed at different BPMs, right? So I've got this one here, which is at 90 BPM, and it's kind of like a drum and bass groove, and it's quite fast. And I just wanted to illustrate, if I play this beat, and the kind of the thing about that is you can see whenever I do these kind of fast 16th note kind of phrasings and these little rolls here, I'm actually having to drag notes like off the grid. They're not on like proper grid values. And it just slows you down a little bit without the snapping, and you can kind of get slightly wonky results if you're not, you know, it basically means you have to be constantly quantizing everything to make sure that it's definitely on 32nd note values. Yeah, it just kind of makes things a little bit harder to visualize, and it can kind of get a bit messier if you're kind of doing faster things like that, right? So with the exact same groove, if I set my sequencer to 180, which is double that value, and I check out what that exact same groove looks like, but programmed at that tempo, you can see I've actually got like a defined grid space for each one of those sort of hits. And just for kind of like faster, if you want to go into fast choppy things like this, it just makes your life a lot easier and it's just faster to kind of edit and work with. Some people might not like it for the sort of robotic feel that it creates, but you can kind of easily slightly address that if you just command A everything, select everything, go to the functions MIDI transform window, and there's this little humanize setting in here. And if you hit operate on that, you can see that what it does is it kind of subtly drags all your hits around onto kind of like off-grid values to kind of, yeah, make it sound a little bit more human, which is cool because it's still like tight to the grid, but it's just got a bit more of a slightly subtler natural feel to kind of cure that griddiness, I guess. So and yeah, so for example, if my song feels like it's slower than that, even if it's at like half that tempo and the song groove is actually at 90 BPM, for example, a sort of hip hop thing, it's still really useful to just program the drums in double time. I like to do a lot of grooves that kind of go between slow fast and kind of like feel like they're speeding up and slowing down. And yeah, if you just got the sequencer set a bit fast, then it just kind of helps you to get there. If your tune's already fast and it's, you know, if it's a genre like drum and bass or something, that's typically around 170 to 180 BPM. So your sequencer is probably already going to be set around there. But for example, if you're making like hip hop or where it's kind of like a half time slower feel, still helpful to just double time the sequencer for that kind of reason, basically. So if you happen to be in Ableton, it just looks a bit different and it's kind of knowing where to find each tool. The other thing is, the problem with Ableton is it doesn't really have a built-in drum kit designer like Logic does. Most of its built-in drum sounds are kind of more like drum machine sample-based kits rather than trying to kind of emulate the behavior of a realistic kit. But the A-cuff preset is kind of usable for that if you go to the drum section here. So in Ableton, velocities are adjusted in this little menu here. And you can see that each note kind of has like these nodes for velocities that you can come in and grab.
Did you say nerd?
Not nerd, node.
So it's the same thing, it's just controlled a little bit of a different way. And the same thing applies with all the quantization options. You can either access this by going to the edit menu and opening up quantize settings, and that should then open this menu in Ableton 12. They've kind of changed where this is, and you now have this kind of, I think it's all in the clip options where you used to get like a little pop-up box that used to turn up. Now it's in this part of the user interface here, so. Okay, I'm going to wrap this up here for today. Things will get a bit more fun and interesting in the next video, where I'll be breaking down how to actually sequence a whole bunch of different grooves in a bunch of different styles, including things like hip hop and drum and bass, jungle, metal, progressive rock and jazz, UK garage, kind of weird techers, math rock sort of beats, and sort of more silly, sophisticated, dumb, complicated bollocks. And once I've done that, it should have explained how to achieve basically any style of music or groove feel that you can think of. I'll also get into Addictive Drums 2 and some more programming tips of that. I'm also going to hook it up to an EQ kit and kind of record some parts with it that way and do a kind of demonstration of tones and stuff like that with it. So, but yeah, anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I hope there's been some useful information in here for anybody. Catch you in the next one, and take it easy.